And we are live and recording.
Hello, everyone. Oh, I'm echoing. Andi, can you mute for us? Thank you. Hello, everyone.
Oh. Janine, do you have more than one tab open on Crowdcast? And you know, on mute. Okay, so while we're having technical difficulty, I will introduce our speakers then. So we're having today with us Andi Orlowski and Bruno Petrungaro. So Andi is Director of Health Economics Union and is Health Economics Modeler in Imperial College Partners. They're going to talk to us about causal inference, and then we will be able to also answer your questions at the end. So now over to you, Andi and Bruno.
Cool, thank you ever so much. And let me just share my screen properly. I don't have as many fruits or grains as Ellen, and I now regret this, but I can promise you one of FBI's most wanted as we talk about causal inference in population health management. And as I get closer to 50, you'll realize that I'll do lots of the talking about the concepts, but the amazing Bruno, my ex-colleague and future colleague, will talk about the practicalities of how we can start to use some of this, these new approaches for population health management. So I'm Andi Orlowski, Director of the Health Economics Unit, and I'm also a Senior Population Health Advisor at NHS England, where I do a lot of talking about PHM, and hopefully today is about some of the doing. So I'm going to run through segmentation, risk stratification, and impactability or amenability, because these are the kind of three main concepts we use in population health analytics to help health systems better understand their populations and then target the right resources, the right things in the right interventions in the right place. And Bruno will talk about approaches that he will take to manage this. So the really exciting thing is, and last week we have worked with NHS England, and we've now struck a partnership where we'll be doing real impactability modelling, something that people have been talking about for a while, and bringing it to systems across the country, taking code and approaches. So if you have done some, so when we go through this and you realise that you've already done something like that, please let me know and we can get in touch and include that code and share it across the NHS. So a quick whistle stop tour, because Bruno is the star of the show. So first of all, segmentation, as many of you know, it's the process of grouping together individuals, because you know summary statistics won't work and to be able to tell you everything. So what we want is a segment that classifies these features, but you know, you've got to be distinct from each other. So as a general rule, you can only ever be in one segment at a time. Yeah. And so we use this to kind of better understand our population characteristics. And the reason we do it is, as I said, we have these great big distribution curves, great big Poisson tails. And so summary statistics, these outliers, skew the results or maybe ignored through doing summary statistics. So understanding the average number of activities or the average cost, and these just do not help us manage those distinct parts of our population, especially people who may be facing poorer access to healthcare. They may be BME populations, they may be places with higher deprivation, and because they're not, you know, if we summarize these things and create averages, it doesn't give us the right answers. So complex systems need a better understanding. And so, and of course, people with lots and lots of different needs. And so, and because they're so unevenly distributed, we need to kind of put them in smaller, more defined boxes. So so what we try to do is measure the system performance of this subpopulation and therefore direct the resources where needed. It allows us to probe into certain segments where we see unwarranted or inexplicable variation between time periods or other areas. It helps us better understand what in that segment is driving those changes. And it helps us move to proactive and reactive policies rather than just trying to react. So why are these people ending up with obesity, or let's say it's diabetic foot amputation? Maybe we can look forward through that segment to see what the kind of care pathway for those people and see what we can do differently. And it allows us, very importantly, to predict and plan for these groups to be able to then facilitate the goals of making sure that we avoid those negative outcomes. So as you guys may know, there are four main ways of doing population health segmentation. Again, we can share the slides, and we have all of the studies that we mentioned in here and all of those links. So if you're interested, you can get these from the Health Economics Unit or the Strategy Unit or NHS-R. We'll make sure that they're available. So at the moment, the super sexy stuff is whole population segmentation. So this is the bridges to health type approach. So what we do is look at the whole population in order to achieve the segmentation. Of course, that sounds obvious, yes, and it sounds like we should have been doing this for years. But the big problem we've had, and years ago, we were looking at health utilization. We only had data for those people who were interacting with the system. We didn't have a good steer on those people who are well and not seeing your GP. If you haven't seen your GP for a decade, how do we know how your health has progressed? So, but looking at the whole population, trying to capture that additional data, the integrated data sets we have now, make that much, much better. Audience segmentation, you guys must know from the marketing types who will box us by our education and our consumer habits, but it's really good at focusing targeted messages, because of course that's how the marketing people have used it to be able to get us to act and change our behaviors. Outcome-based segmentation is the kind of stuff I did for years. And so what we tried to do was avoid the heart attack, the stroke. Nearly 99% of my work was trying to stop readmissions or admissions in the first place, however unsuccessfully that was done. But this idea of looking at a single outcome. And finally, the stuff that our friends in public health have done amazingly for years is the geodemographic segmentation. So understanding from your neighborhood and household and that geodemographic data, your potential life course. So from where you're born and where you grow up, you have a really good understanding. And so that's a really rich seam of segmentation data. So on to risk stratification. So we now know how to potentially box people up. But in those boxes, what we want to understand is people's risk of moving from box to box, or potentially of getting a negative outcome. So risk strat is the understanding of where within each segment the greatest risk of having the significant health event or a deterioration. And so what we want to do is have a look at those to target interventions to align healthcare to that individual's need. And this is nearly always done at individual level. So if you're my age and you showed an interest in risk stratification back in the kind of 90s, Kaiser Permanente would have wished you over. Well, if you were a boss, clearly, if you're a scumbag analyst like me, they never invited you. But if you were a boss, you got invited over to see the Pima Indians in Arizona, or you got to go to San Francisco or California. Well, I know San Francisco's in California, but you know what I mean? Over there, somewhere nice. And they would talk about the Kaiser Pyramid that I'm sure you're very familiar with. So the base of the pyramid is the size of your population. As you move up the pyramid, the experience of an X over Y, so your readmission in 30 days, your heart attack in a year. And we look at those groups of populations, the very high risk and the low risk. And what we're really interested in is people moving up that pyramid. How do you go from the green to the blue to the yellow, and the yellow to the red? I spent nearly a huge part of my career having a look at the reds, yes? Because these are the people that we were really interested in. These are the people that had lots of activities. But we'll talk about regression to the mean. And to be fair, we've got Hamid on the line, and no one knows more about changes in variation and regression to the mean than him. But I get to talk today, not him. So risk strats, three kind of approaches: clinical perspective, threshold modeling, predictive modeling, clinical. So these are the guys who are face-to-face with the patients and of course have a knowledge. You work in an A&E, there'll be guys there who'll be able to tell you who's coming in and what they're coming, and you know, and be able to predict with some accuracy those people coming in. Threshold modeling has been used for years and years, so things like CHADS-VASc scores, and by using certain patient characteristics, we can add those characteristics up to create a risk model. And finally, and again, the sexy stuff today, so if you're a system leader or if you're a boss today, predictive modeling. Yes, show some interest in that. I'm sure our friends at IBM and ACG and Johns Hopkins and people whisk you away to talk about predictive modeling. So this is the kind of super sexy stuff, and hopefully the stuff that we'll be using going forward using integrated data sets. So of course, of these, predictive models are recommended as they're the most accurate. Our clinical colleagues are absolutely fantastic at guessing the people who come in, but of course, because they don't have that whole population view, they don't get to see overall, and so they tend to actually perform the worst. And predictive models are consistently perform better. And there are some amazing things already out there for free that many of you may have used already, but if not, you can get. So patients at risk of readmission, so PAR and PAR 30, so that's readmission in 30 days. The combined predictor model developed by the King's Fund, which is basically PAR plus some primary care data smashed together to make it even more accurate. There's the ACG developed by Johns Hopkins. There's an S missed off there. I must change these slides. Johns Hopkins University, which you have to pay for, and also Q admissions. All of these models are reasonably similar in terms of the predicted performance. PAR and combined are free. Anyway, so now we understand our segments. We understand why we're doing risk strat and the models that we can do it. Quite often, healthcare systems are told, how can we save resources? So where do we concentrate on? We're all taught at school, you know, it's small percentages of big numbers are much easier than big percentages of small numbers. Yeah, it makes sense. So what we do is concentrate on the big numbers here, the 16 million and the 15 million, and then we're looking at the population sizes, 2,500 to 27,000. So you know where you're gonna spend your time and money and effort. You're gonna spend it on the two long-term conditions at over 65, because each one of those would make a huge difference to the pot. Yeah, so we can make small differences there on these big numbers will make a huge difference. And this is what this man would have taught us. So I don't have grapes or avocado. I have Slick Willy. One, I get to say Slick Willy out loud, which is hilarious, even if I'm 40, sorry, 50. But Slick Willy, AKA William Sutton, was a bank robber. He was caught three times. He escaped three times. He is a folk hero across the US. When the FBI created a most wanted list, he was on it. So the very first top 10 most wanted, Willie Sutton was on there. And when he got caught for the fourth time, they say, Willie, why do you keep robbing banks? And of course, he looked at the camera and just said, because that's where the money is. Yes, Sutton's Law was born. We teach it to clinicians and medics today, where you hear hoofbeats, think horses, not zebras. You go for the obvious. Yes, that's what Willie taught us. That's what we should do for our segmentation. We should go for the obvious things. Yeah, makes sense. No, of course not, because if it was that easy, we would have cracked this years ago. So there's this problem with impactability, a horrible American word, or amenability to change. So what we need to understand is which of those patients, when we find them in our segment and we see that they're deteriorating or they have a rising risk, who is most likely to respond to the preventative care being offered? Because if they were responding, we would hopefully manage that care. So there are approaches to looking at impactability modelling, and this is the work that we're going to be doing with NHS England. I'm really, really excited to be doing this stuff. But we're going to be looking at ambulatory care sensitive conditions, you know, gap analysis, excluding patients are likely to respond. We'll come back to that in a sec. And impactable moments and rising risks. So I'll race through those so you can get to Bruno and how he will start to deal with these. So, you know, ACS conditions. So simply finding those patients, you know, who have, you know, an ambulatory care center condition, which means that they're most likely to be amenable to upstream care. So we know the vast majority of COPD admissions are amenable to upstream care, and there may be other factors involved. So they may have maxed out their meds, so there may be no more inhalers, or they've got the strongest strengths they can be. Maybe there's something else that would change, and there was work done in the Northeast, supported by NHS England, where we went to people's homes and we gave them better, more efficient boilers, because it was actually the terrible homes which were damp and mold filled that were causing the multiple admissions, even though they were on high dose steroids and the best inhaler. So there are other things that you can do. So who's amenable to change for those AC, you know, the ambulatory care centered conditions? Next, gap analysis. So very simply, we have nice, clearly defined evidence-based interventions across a pathway. NICE help us write these out. Yeah, so NICE have done so much work for the major conditions. So where in the patient's pathway have they not had the intervention that they should have had, or if they've had it, have they not engaged with it appropriately? So if they're a diabetic, did they get the education advice? Did they go to Desmond or Daphne? Did they like it? Did they actually care and pay attention? But did they have the education? Then was it metformin, DPP-4, SGL-2? I apologize if I've got those the wrong way around. It's so many acronyms, but you understand it's there's a nice clear care pathway. Have they followed that care pathway? And are there opportunities for us to engage them with those drugs, all those interventions, to be able to help prevent the PEH? So where are their gaps? And then we can start to look at who has the most gap scores when you're looking at people in a population with complex conditions and rising risk. And then maybe we can weight those gap scores. So somebody, let's say a controlled diabetic who's missed a foot exam. It's important that they have their foot exams, but if they have a good HbA1c and they miss their foot exam, is that a higher risk than someone with an uncontrolled HbA1c? And is there a weight difference there? And maybe if that patient happens to be in the target weight where you've got a patient who's obese with a higher HbA1c, and then maybe someone with a high CHADS VAS score, so someone with a risk of an AF-related stroke, is that risk higher than the foot amputation? And again, how do we weight and manage those gaps? Excluding patients unlikely to respond. So if you're an evil American insurance company, what you want to do is identify patients with stable, long-term characteristics, because who will cost you a fortune, because you want to price them out of the pool or make it very expensive for them to stay in the insurance pool. People who may be substance abusers have a language barrier if they speak Spanish rather than English, because of course you may get the same response in healthcare, but you may need to pay for an interpreter or someone to work with you, or people with long-term mental health issues that may mean that they're harder to work with. So if you're an insurance company, you use these tools to be able to identify people at risk of change and try to price them out of the pool. But because we're not like them and we're the NHS, we can use the same techniques to identify people at risk of facing health inequalities. So these same people who need additional help to get the same response, we can use the same approaches. But for us, we now know that we may need to make an additional effort to get the response. So it's a great way of us being able to address health inequalities, even though they use it for the other way around. And as we get near the end, impactful moments. Do the patients that we're talking to actually meet and interact with the system? Do they have a rapidly rising risk score compared to people with a slower risk score? Are these people more potentially amenable to change? And finally, patient activation measures. Is the patient ready to engage better and to be more involved in their healthcare? Because if so, they may be patients we can help work with. So here you've seen these boxes. Of course, it's very difficult to kind of point at the boxes here, but as you see these red dots, this is this idea of people who are costing much, much more than you would expect for the mean for that. Is this a quick way of identifying impactable patients, because there are outliers in the costs associated with them? Are there other factors, other things that we can do besides adding more drugs, besides adding more things to make a difference? So why is this really important? Why is impactability and amenability really important? And here's a quick show for you. So number of emergency hospital admissions per head per month. And this is from one of the new care models, as you know, that they were asked or tasked to prevent or to try and reduce the number of readmissions. So a nice model showing people going up. Because we're good analysts, we find a great counterfactual. There we go. Very, very similar. And so we're all very chuffed that we've done a very good job of our analytics. So the trust puts in place its intervention, and bang, look at it dropped straight down. This is a success. Parties all round. We're going to get some extra funding from NHS England. But of course, then we look at the counterfactual and bollocks. Yes, the counterfactual has done just as well as, in fact, if not a bit better than the previous than the active group. And so it shows you that these people weren't amenable to that change. And so additional resources and funding was spent, and it could have been spent better or in a different place with a different opportunity to try and make those differences. Because of this regression to the mean for these patients, you either get better or you tend to die. So these are the important bits. So now, as we talk through these kind of concepts, I'm going to pass over to Bruno. Bruno?
I'm sure Bruno's here.
Bruno's left me to do the difficult bit.
Sorry. No. I was trying to share the screen.
He knows how bad I am at R, which is why he's going to try and tell me to do something.
So I would like to talk about basically about causal inference, mostly focused on Bayesian networks. So an example of what can be done, what can be done with this type of techniques is suppose a patient wants to consult a clinician. In the clinician, in his mind, with his knowledge, starts building cause and effects mechanisms. If the patient showed this symptom must be this cause or this cause because this symptom is also present. So with this type of techniques, though we will not reach this far in this slide pack, you could potentially automate those decisions, replicate the process that happened in the clinician's mind and automate it in a computer. So a system that is like this is not called artificial intelligence, it's called an expert system because it's restricted to a very particular domain. So suppose we have three variables, smoking, lung cancer, and heart disease. If we were doing a normal regression, that regression wouldn't be able to tell us the direction of the effect. In this case, we can see that lung cancer is a good predictor of smoking, it's correlated with smoking, but actually we know that this is the way that the relationship should go. Smoking causes both lung cancer and heart disease. And being able to understand this structure of how smoking impacts both lung cancer and heart disease, we know that if we want to reduce the probability of developing lung cancer or heart disease, we need to intervene on smoking. Simple associational scores wouldn't be able to tell us that. So from Andy's talk, we can see that he spoke about risk stratification, which he essentially says predicting who's at greater risk of having a significant health event. Well, a Bayesian network can make this prediction, and it has its benefits compared to standard methods. In the network structures that are built, we can clearly see the relationships among the many variables, which is not the case on a regression. How Bayesian networks are structured are very easy to carry out what if analysis, and the opposite reasoning from cost to effect, not to effect to cost, and it's very easy to augment Bayesian networks to transform it into a decision network where we can choose the action that will maximize the utility. In this case, will probably be an action trying to reduce the risk of patients. So in terms of the impactability modeling that Andy was talking about, we can also simulate interventions with Bayesian networks. So the standard our package, I would say, to work with Bayesian networks in R is be and learn. When I signed up for this talk, Professor Mohamed recommended Dagiti, which is basically a web tool, and it's very good for visualizing directed cyclical graphs. Bayesian networks are definitely a part of it, and it also comes as an R package that it can be used in R. So what is a Bayesian network? Well, a Bayesian network, a very basic one, would look just like this. We can see that we have nodes that represent variables A, B, C, D. We can see that we know that that B has a parent A, and a child, and a child E. Andi has parents B and C and an ancestor A. And A has a descendant D. So it's a way of naming the relation of where you are in the structure relative to the variable you're looking. So Bayesian networks are directed a cyclic graph because if you can see there is no cycles. If we start in A, there is no way that the arrows will lead us back to A. Dagitis has some useful commands that will allow you to find the relationships which are the parents of a variable, which are the ancestors, and so forth. So after we have the structures of a Bayesian network, in this case we started with something like this, we need to be able to quantify the relationship between the nodes. This is done by specifying the conditional probability tables. So in this case, for example, the probability of cancer if the patient smoked would be given by this number, which is a 10% probability. So in this case, I just started with giving the structure based on some knowledge of what smoking causes. And this is a perfectly valid approach. So you can build a structure of a Bayesian network based on knowledge. And also you can build the conditional probability tables based on knowledge. You can adopt a pure data-driven approach and find the structure and the probability tables just based on the data, or you can combine both approaches. Generally, sometimes the structure is given by knowledge and the conditional probability tables are given by the data. So we have three causal classes to identify. One is called a causal chain, which is just that a variable X causes a variable Y, and this one causes a variable Z. We have a relationship called common cause, where the variable Y causes both X and Z. And we have a common effect, where the variable Y is the common effect of both X and Z. So to learn the structure of a Bayesian network by the data, we have two types of algorithms. One are called constraint-based or causal discovery, and they basically test for the variables to see if which ones are causing each other. And it tests them in a way that it orders them in the three causal classes we saw. And then score-based algorithms that are more of a classic machine learning type of algorithm, which we're basically trying to see what better fits the data in more of a predictive modeling kind of sense of a way. So a constraint, the example that I provide of a constraint-based algorithm is the PC algorithm. So very simply, and as a summary, the algorithm starts by building an undirected graph where all the variables are connected. And then it performs at a conditional independence test, so to see if, for example, these two should still be connected or this arch should be removed. After that, it just tries to order the all the variables in this type of fashion, and that how the network is built. So the PC stable command in BNLearn runs a version of this algorithm. But it's just generally, it always starts with just checking the the conditional independence of the variables. So an example of the score-based algorithm is a hill climbing search. So basically, the algorithm requires an initial best guess graph, a graph where you want to start, and then it starts moving to neighboring graphs. So by basically would be like deleting an arc or building a new arc or reversing. So if this had an arrow, then put it back. And if one of those neighbors improves the fit, let's say that way, improves the fit, then you pick that neighbor graph and move to there, and then you start trying to find a new neighbor from that graph. If no neighbor that increases score is found, then the process stops and the algorithm will return the graph selected. So in Bayesian networks allow to simulate interventions. So basically an intervention could be of the form of, for example, setting the probability of conditional probability to some value, and I hear noise, so.
We can't hear Janine, but I think they may be saying we've got 5 minutes left, Bruno.
Okay. Here is try to deliberately action on a variable and try to set the distribution of probabilities to some value. If you have a long-term condition, maybe you want to study the effect of something. If you set that patient to have that long-term condition with 100% probability, it's just basically a way to simulate what would happen if people adopt the profile. And that was it.
Sorry about this. I'm not sure Janine can unmute herself. I'm not sure why, and I'm trying to unmute her as well. I can see people really enjoying the session. I can see Mohammed is clapping, which I unfortunately can't hear because of the software. And we have 3 minutes for questions. So shall we quickly go through them then? So we have question from Janine, actually, and which is the most popular one. So if you target interventions to people most likely to engage with the intervention, so does it raise the risk of inequality? Mm-hmm. You're kind of biasing it. I don't know, Andi or Bruno, do you want to answer this?
Yeah, well, and this is one of the key things that we have to make sure is that the interventions that we're looking at engage the right communities. And so there's some wonderful work being done at Knots ICS. So please have a look at what those guys are doing. They're deliberately finding interventions that target those with the highest possible need. So those in those segments in the risk stratification who may have a high risk, but how do we get interventions that work at those populations that may be with higher deprivation or the least or the worst access to healthcare? So those interventions may cost more. We may need to change what we're offering to that population. So we keep the care the same for everybody else, but we tailor something special for them. So hopefully impactability helps address inequalities rather than making them worse. But it's a really key point.
I don't know, Bruno, do you want to add anything?
No, I think Andi covered it all.
But I'm sure we have a question for you, because I'm pretty sure next question is about package. So do B and Learn support longitudinal data modeling with equal and equal lags for different variables? Are you able to answer this, Bruno?
Sorry, I didn't quite understand. Maybe I can read somewhere.
Yeah, I think you should, because I'm being awful treating apparently.
So if you click on ask a question, you can see.
Yeah, there is a second question about B and Learn. I'm not sure if it's package or not. The scene, I don't know if you want to jump and comment about your question.
Yeah, I don't know if the equal and unequal lags are supported, sorry.
Okay, it's okay. I'm pretty sure we can just try to answer it on Slack later, possibly. And then we have a last question. We have 1 minute literally left. So what about omitted variables biases? So can these techniques deal with the bias from missed variables? I don't know, Andi or Bruno?
Bruno, how do we manage and input the missing variables?
Yeah, and also generally, at least the things would have to be imputed first, or in the case that, I mean, you're just in the case that we're working just with discrete Bayesian networks, then you would just probably put it as a separate class. But yeah, no, it's not made for that specifically.
Okay, thank you for this.
And just a real quickie, when we opened the Festival of Analytics, we talked about the perils of analytics, and we did a section there on data bias and how we kind of approach and manage data bias. So I know that talk's available from the strategy unit, and we'll make those slides. I'm writing a blog about it right now.
Brilliant. So do you have a link somewhere by hand you can share? Well,
I think it has to be signed off by you before it's published. So it's
okay, well, sorry about this, but we will share with everyone on Slack, definitely. And then, sorry, I know we're a bit around this time, but we started the session quite late as well. Last question then from Marta. What's the difference between using B and Learn and Dagiti?
Well, I mean, I'm not a Dagiti expert, definitely was a Mohammed recommendation, but yeah, for example, trying to, when I was preparing the talk, trying to find the algorithms to actually build a structure for the Bayesian network, I couldn't find it. So for what I see from Dagiti, it's a very, very useful tool. I would say I really like the web-based version, and it's very good to visualizing these networks after you have it. But I guess B and Learn is more directed to training those networks.
Thank you. Well, it was absolutely fantastic session. Again, I can see all this clapping happening, which you can't hear, unfortunately, but we can see. And thank you once again, Andi and Bruno. And for everyone, as usually, you will be pulled automatically, session starts, but you also can use drop-down menu on the top left corner. I'm not going to show the right direction, but somewhere here to go to the next session. So thank you, Andi and Bruno, and we hope we will see you again in our future events. Bye, all.
Bye-bye. Yeah.